We live back at the end of this little road, and you can see that other folks used to live here. One of the old homesteads is right here. I think 17 families altogether lived around this little loop back here at one time 150 years ago or so. I want to talk about roads. I want to talk about the way into your purpose, how to get into the thing God really intended for you to have. And I'm going to do that from the life of Jacob and how he came to Bethel and then on from Bethel, El Bethel, and then came a little bit farther. It was a rough road. You know, this road is rough. I bring my tractor up here with my box blade and grade it once in a while, but it's a tough road. And that road into the third dimension is not an easy way. It's a rough road. As a matter of fact, Jacob lost the thing he loved the most on the way to Ephratah. But it was worth it, and I promise when you hear this word today, you're going to think it's worth it. And I hope you'll take this walk with us.
Genesis chapter 35, I'm going to read beginning with verse 16. I'll read four verses, and the fourth verse will hold my text. It's not a new theme with me. It's one I've been progressing in for a long time. And they journeyed from Bethel, and there was but a little way to come to Ephratah. And Rachel travailed, and she had hard labor. It came to pass, when she was in hard labor, that the midwife said unto her, "Fear not, thou shalt have this son also." Man, I wish I had time to preach about that, the voice of the midwives. Remember when she had the first child, that would be Joseph, her firstborn. The midwife said, "Thou hast borne a son." But when this child, Benoni, was born, she said, "Thou shalt have this child also." Came to pass, as her soul was in departing, because she died, that she called his name Benoni, but his father called him Benjamin. Rachel died and was buried in the way to Ephratah, which is Bethlehem. My text will be the way to Ephratah. The way to Ephratah. There is an underlying and an immediate theme in my spirit that I'll announce to you at the outset. I want to let you know where I'm going, because it'll take me a while to get there. I don't want you to get weary on the trip. I think that with all we have and all God has given us, in average Christianity and in mundane charismata, there's a tendency to find a spot and settle. There's a tendency in all of us to locate, not geographically so much as spiritually. We look back to the days when we were learning and learning and learning and growing and growing and growing, but there's a ceasing point in us so often, a place we find comfortable enough, and what we perceive to be a place lofty enough in God that we are satisfied to remain. We're pleased to stay. I think we are at the threshold and the door of the great coming in to the greatest dimension of God that there is. I don't want to seem to say that we have nothing, because we have so much in Christ, and we understand a great deal about Him and about His cause. And because of these ministries and this guiding Father ministry in this house, we understand a great deal about the kingdom of God that has not been preached. We've been preached church, but we haven't been preached kingdom. Jesus came to establish a kingdom, and we've been introduced again, and we know something about that. I have been ministering now in the last approximately 7 years on what I consider to be the most important theme of my ministry of 35 years, and that is the seventh day of God. I am misunderstood by many people for even approaching it because other men have touched it in years gone by, and because it wasn't understood, or because they had some other difficult doctrine running alongside, it was maligned, and it was sometimes then gone awry. But there is a day in God that is a day of rest. The fourth chapter of Hebrews. Now, you've heard me talk about this. I hit it every time I preach. Anything I preach, I'm going to get on that. You understand that? Because I think that is the thesis and the foundation for every message we preach in the kingdom. I don't think the kingdom can be built in the sixth day. Last time, or night time before when I was here, we were talking about the frogs in the pond. Remember, I talked to you about a like-as principle. Everything is like something. And I said, a day is with the Lord. It didn't say it is 1,000 years. That's where the dispensationalists got all tangled up. They said it is 1,000 years. God didn't say it is 1,000 years. He said it is as 1,000 years. He only uses the marker of time for our mortality because we're dying people. God lives in eternity. He doesn't live in time. So God isn't checked out in some kind of little segments or pieces of what we call time. With us, we've got it all chopped up, starting with moments. And then we have minutes. And then we have hours. And then we have days. And then we have weeks. And then we have months. And then we have years. And we've got these segmented little chips all thrown in time so we can mark our way along toward our death. But God lives in eternity, seeing the end from the beginning, doesn't need any of those, and doesn't need to guard himself by where he was or where he's going, because he's been there and is there already. Having said that, if a day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, then we have 4,000 years from Adam to Jesus. Four is the number of qualification. Anytime you see four in Scripture, it qualifies something. If you get an eldership, they have to be able men, such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness. If you qualify evil, it's principalities, powers, rulers of the spirit of this world, spiritual wickedness in high places. 1, 2, 3, 4. Qualification. Temptations come in four. Judgmental temptations sometimes come in 4 times 10, 40. Are you all still here? This is not numerology. These are just segments of continuity in Scripture. It just falls out that way. Sixes all fall on top of each other. Sevens all fall on top of each other. Seven trumpets, seven vials, seven angels, seven messengers, seven stars, all, and 7 days. But the Scripture says in Hebrews 4 that God labored 6 days, and then he ceased from his labor. Isn't it a marvelous thing to understand kingdom truth that God did not get up and work for you today? God hasn't worked for you all week. Matter of fact, God didn't work for you last year. The Bible said all his works were finished from the creation of the world. I wish I had time to preach on kingdom prayer. And I'd tell you that while common churchianity has taught us that we pray to inform God, to let God know what's going on. If we didn't get up and pray in the morning, God would have no idea what to do. And we then create our own ideas out of our carnal minds. We put these things all together, bring an amalgamation of man's wisdom and man's thought and man's ingenuity, fashioned after world systems, things we parrot, things we see, get it together, put it on white paper, stick it in a manila folder, and then say, we're going to fast and pray for God to bless this. We made it, but we want God to bless it. God doesn't bless anything he doesn't create. So we're pleading for anointing on stuff that God cannot anoint because he didn't create it. That's why real kingdom praying is not telling God what's wrong, but just finding out what God has already done from the foundation of the world and speaking it in the now. And that is what brings power. 4,000 years from Adam to Jesus would be as 4 days. How many days does that leave in a week? 3. Two of those days would be days of labor. But the third dimension, which would be the three dimensions of grace, the third dimension would be the seventh day of God. I say this enough times that I hope you will not ever forget that. The seventh day of God, the day in which he rested. And the scripture says, as God rested from his labors, so we should rest from ours. Only in the seventh day, or the third dimension of grace, does God build his kingdom. The kingdom cannot be built in second day mentality. The kingdom will not be built in old Christian warrings over doctrines and issues and fightings. Teaching has to be done. But that is not where kingdom is built. Information should be given to people who are coming in. But people who come in should go out with power. Death, burial, help me. Where's the power? Father, Son, body, soul. The kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it is righteousness, peace, and joy. Now abideth these three: faith, hope, and the greatest of these is why? Because it's the third of the threes. Because it's the third dimension of grace. Because it is all God. The Romans can kill him. Joseph of Arimathea can bury him, but only God can raise the dead. The power of God is in the third dimension of grace. Now to my text. I am reading the latter stories of this man, Jacob. When he started out, he was not the man we read about here on his way to Ephratah. He was a weasel and a skunk. He started his dirty business before he was born. His mama's having twins. Where's Mona? She just having one. Thank God. His mama's having twins. Rebecca's having twins. She's going to have a baby. He's a big old hawking looking kind of a child. He's going to grow up to be a ruddy, red. They call him Esau. His name can be translated Edom. Dirt, mud, red. He's a crusty kind of a guy. He'll eventually grow up to be vulgar. The scripture says he's profane. He's vain. He's lusty. He's born first, typical of the old nature. You know the second birth always gets the blessing. You know that. Got to be born again. When he's coming out of the womb, the midwife, push, honey, push, push. Sweat, groaning, moaning. I don't even want to think about that. Here comes this baby. She's got him, and she starts to pull him out. She goes, oh, he's got a growth on his foot. Looks like a hand. Truth is, the other little guy who's still in there, that's Jacob. He reached out, caught him by the heel. You ain't going no place without me. Started out being a weasel. Started out being a mess. Well, I don't have time for all of this, but you remember that Jacob's beginnings were rusty and rough, full of deception. He's called a supplanter. He's a deceiver. He's not a choir boy. He's not the best kid in the class. He's not going to get any gold stars in Sunday school. This boy is a mess. You understand? You got to get that picture. He's a rascal. When he starts out, he has an enmity immediately with his brother. Of course, you know, Esau, he's grown up fast. and he lives fast, and he's out chasing women. He's over yonder somewhere across 40 pastures looking for other pastures. He's out. The Bible says he spent his living. He was out with harlots. He's busy with profanity and evidently with lewd things. Jacob's at home, but he's looking for a way to take over something. Sometimes the things we consider evil in men are only misguided anointings. A man who will do everything in the world to sell you a car probably is an unsaved evangelist. You understand what I'm talking about? And I believe every really great college professor probably was born to be an apostle. I think that gifts are born and only can be, or at least the seed is there, and only lives and resurrects at the touch of he who became the first fruits of them that slept. And so those gifts sleep until they're touched by the first fruit. But that's neither here nor there. What is important in my text right now is that as Jacob grew, they became boys, then men, and enmity is constantly aspiring between them. Esau's out of town, and Isaac is ill. Father is ill. Jacob's daddy is sick. He's not doing well. He's in bed. He's got pneumonia. He's got something. He's not doing well. He's old. And he's thinking he's not going to live. So he lets it be known to his dear wife that he'd like to have a last meal. As a matter of fact, he tells Esau when he finally did come in, Esau, I'd like you to go and get me some venison. The Bible said Esau was a man of the field. He's a hunter. He said, go kill me a deer. Bring me some venison. Cook it the way you always did. Only he must have probably said, say, boy, you know how you used to bring me venison before I pass. He got him. Information. He wanted a little taste of that wild meat. He wanted one more time to break bread with his oldest son. This is the man who will inherit the birthright, the right of the firstborn. He's the one who will get 2/3 of his father's goods. He's the one who will carry on the patriarchal lineage. But in the meantime, Jacob, the sneak, has caught his older brother coming in from one of his drunks or something. And he's been out without food for a while, and he swindled him out of the birthright. You know, it worries me a little bit about Jacob because he's cooking a lot. But I think by what we see about him in his later life, he's okay. But I worried about the gene strain in him a little because he was cooking beans and then later he's cooking a goat. But now, you know, and he's always talking to mama. Now that worries me. I want to make sure he's got his screws tightened up in his wrists and everything's okay. But it looks like by the time we get to my text, he's okay. But he's cooking beans. He's cooking lentils. He's cooking pottage. Esau, come and give me some of that stuff. No, wait a minute. Hey, I've been working on this a while. You can't just come in there like that and get that. We're going to cut us a deal here. And so he said, I want some of that pottage. Give me some of that. He said, no, wait a minute. Wait. Sell me your birthright. No, I got to sell me your birthright. Nothing to it, you know. Just come on, let's cut a little deal here. And so he sold his birthright, his right of birth, his right for patriarchal honor. We're always worried about the men who sell out. But I worry about the ones who bought and didn't go on. He sold his birthright for a bowl of beans. And then when it comes time for the blessing on the oldest son, this is what the old man really said. go and get me some venison, and I'm going to lay my hands on you, son, and I'm going to bless you. Well, Jacob knew it was really his mama who came and told him, hey, Papa's going to bless Esau. He knew he could have the birthright. He can have a gift. But the birthright without the blessing is like an engine without gasoline. Having a gift without favor. Having a talent without a consecration. Having an ability without a consistency. This man, conniving as he was, knew that his birthright was invalid if he didn't get the hand of his father laid square down on his head. He knew he had to have that blessing. And so as soon as Esau has gone to the field, he and his mother have the head together. What are we going to do? Well, we need to get something. Well, I can't kill a deer. No way. Let's kill the nanny goat. I mean, after all, he's old. Papa can't tell. He's not going to know the difference in a goat and a deer. You know, we'll cook it the way Esau does, over the open fire. We'll get the loin out of the back. Come on, take the butcher knife and go get him. I'm not going to do that. Well, son, I'm not going to do it for you. Well, come out with me. He worries me. Out in the backyard. Poor old goat, she's done nothing but just lovingly give milk and raise kids for them. And she's standing there in the way of destiny, right there hooked up to the fence. Wasn't nothing she did wrong, wasn't anything she bargained for, she just happened to be close at hand. I really don't think you want me to go into detail about this butchering, but see, it wasn't just a simple deal. I mean, they're going to butcher this goat. You understand what I'm saying? They're going to butcher this goat. I'm thinking probably I guess the easy way is just to cut his throat. Are y'all okay? We got to talk about things like this. You know, not enough real preaching in the world. Got to cut his throat, and then it's going to lay there and flip a little bit and flop. It's going to bleed out. You got to let it bleed out. That way the meat's going to get tender if you let it bleed out. And then if you just shake it a little bit, it'll bleed out a little bit more. And by that time, Jacob, he's got him a leather tether up over a limb, probably over the low bough of an oak. An oak, strange out in this wilderness. Its root is always sucking and begging for the moisture somewhere a long way down below the dusty sands of Canaan. And there over the bough of that oak, he stretches that leather thong and ties it to the back hocks, presses a hole with the knife between the back tendon and the bone, and strings a stick between the two, stretches it out, pulls it up. And then the process of emptying out the entrails. You got to be careful. You have to be really careful when you do that, starting from the sternum, cutting up so that you don't cut into the abdomen of the animal. And then when you get up to the pelvic area, cutting down, but if you don't have a bone chip or an axe, then it's better to cut around the sphincter and carry the intestine back and forth and pull it back and forth until you pull it back down into the cavity. Be careful now that you don't spill. Don't spill the bladder on the meat, it makes it bitter. And pulling it out and pulling it down, all the way down, and then finally reaching in, pulling out the lungs and down in and cutting deep down. Don't look at me like that. They had to do that. They had to do that if they're going to get this ruse taken care of. And then way down, cutting the windpipe way up as high as you can reach into the animal carcass. And then starting at the back hock, cutting around just above the joint of the knee and pulling down hard on the skin until they expose the back loin. And there, with some sharp stone or metal instrument, they peeled away from the side of the backbone and above the top part of the cartilage of the rib cage, what we know as filet mignon from a goat. They peel it away and pull it down. It's going to be about the size of a silver dollar and about 14 inches long, one on each side of the backbone. And if you slice it just about a quarter of an inch thick, and if you string it on a stick and put it over a hot open fire, 10 minutes of hot fire on that. And then if you take just a little bit of that, and press it and beat it with a stone in the bottom of a of a pan or on the bottom of some kind of a platter or some kind of a sauce dish. Then it gets some of the juice out, pour a little bit of goat milk on that. Mix it just a little bit, put in a little bit of herbs and a little bit of spice and a little bit of leek in that and stir it around. And then by the time you get it to daddy on a platter, just little old silver dollars of mignon. And on top of that is that good warm gravy that you spread on there. And when you get that all out spicy and good, and then they took the skin from the goat and wrapped it on Jacob's arms, because he's got a problem. His brother's hairy. They should have called him hairy. I don't know how come they called him Esau. But Jacob is, he's slick as a button. When he comes in before his father to put on this rank deception, he comes in and says, holding, of course, the platter, wearing, of course, the goat skin to imitate the arms of Esau. Here you are. Here you are, father. I thought that would bring you this, this last meal before, before... Interrupted by the old man. He might be nearly dead, but he's not all that dead. He said, come over here and let me feel you. Well, when he put out his arm, he said, come on, nanny goat. All wrapped up. It sounds like the voice of Jacob, but it's got to be Esau, that old hairy arm. He couldn't tell the difference in a nanny goat and his oldest boy. I'm telling you, the man was pretty far gone. Pretty far gone. Trying to eat that filet mignon. Ain't got no teeth left. Push it back in my mouth, boy. Got a real problem here. Can't hardly get that thing chewed up. Jacob's just standing there going, oh, yes, 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 yes. He got his head. And then his father, as soon as he got a little of that broth on his tongue, swallowed a little bit of that venison. He turned around and said, put your head here, boy. I'm going to bless you now. When he reached out, Jacob stuck that head out there. He couldn't wait to get that hand on his head. He had to have that blessing. As soon as he had the blessing, his mother said, you better get out of here, and you better get out of here now. As a matter of fact, he hung around a little too long, and Esau came home, and he came in. Here you are, Dad. I got this venison I cooked for you. Here, just the way you like it. And he said,
you've already been in here already once today.
I hadn't been here. I just got back. Been out there cooking on that fire. Looks like somebody killed a goat back there or something.
No, son, I've already eaten the venison, and I've given my blessing.
No, you hadn't given you a blessing. I'm just now God here, Dad. Here I am. Go on, take a bite of this stuff.
No, son.
And then it all starts flowing in on them.
Thy brother hath come with subtlety and hath taken away thy blessing.
And Rebecca heard it. He said, when I see my father dead in his grave, as soon as my daddy dies, I'm going to kill Jacob. And anger and malice burned in him for the loss of that which he had not to this moment coveted. Sometimes when somebody else gets what you already gave away, it angers you. Sometimes when other men pay the price that you wouldn't pay, it upsets you. That really testifies to the fact that you want their crown, but you could not carry their cross. You want their glory, but you would not bear their shame. You're willing to wear the laurel, but you have no intention of running the race. And so was the anger kindled in Esau. I'm going to kill it. I'm gonna kill him! And Rebecca heard him. She said, get out of town and get out now. And he ran for his life. Now, my story. Jacob is running for his life. Only a few things he can carry and pack on one mule. He's gone. He's headed down. He's south and east, and then cutting back west toward Pandanaram. He's headed far on down until he gets finally weary and exhausted from flight, fearing instant and immediate pursuit, looking behind him, stopping at every rock, climbing up on a high place, looking back to see, is there dust? Is he coming? He can ride faster than I can. He can run faster. Is he on his way yet? Has my father died yet? Fear, in the same dimension that anger paralyzed Esau, so fear absolutely took hold of Jacob. And he's running until he is utterly exhausted and absolutely done in. And he, without looking around, he's not checking to see what the best prices are. He's not waiting on a reservation. He's had it. He's gone as far as he can go. He drops over. He loops the rope on the pack horse around some limb, something, anything, pulls down something. He lays on the hard ground, utterly exhausted. His head over on his shoulder, drags up a rock, 2, 3, 4, something to get a little bit of the kink out of his neck, lays his head, and before he knows it, he is in an exhausted sleep. And every once in a while, in his mind, his subconscious, his fear takes over, and he thinks he hears the shouting of pursuing men. And it's nothing but the night sounds and a lone wolf somewhere on up in the rocks. And he tries again to rest. And then again, he hears that something rustling. It's coming. He's coming. He's coming. Ha, ha. And it's nothing but the mule moving back and forth in the brushways, tied. He is full of fear. He is running for his life. And then it was just before dawn that it happened to him. He is in some fitful sleep by this time, and his head on a pillow of stones. And there is a boom, silver shaft shot right down beside his head. Ha! And when he draws back, it's the sword of me. It's the rail rung of some celestial staircase. He's looking at a window in the heavenlies. This is a ladder that stretches from earth to heaven. Angels are ascending, which means they're already here, and descending, coming back here. And at the top of this ladder is the Lord God. He's looking at a vision of the glory of God, and out of his dreamy exhaustion, he rises up to say, "Ho! Surely the Lord is in this place." I didn't even know. I mean, I couldn't have prospected. I couldn't have used a Geiger counter. I couldn't have used a scope. I couldn't have used a laser and found this one spot. I could not have, in visions of 1,000 years of prayer, ever located this hole in the heavenlies. I just happened to drop off here in exhaustion. Where I hit the ground is where God lives. God is in, oh, what a miracle. My God is in this place. I didn't even know it. This is the door of heaven. This is the house of God. And he said, "I tell you, if you'll bring me back to my father's house in peace, I'll give you a tithe of all that I own." He made a covenant with God to pay his tithes more than some folks do. They hadn't been scared enough yet. But got to mark this spot. Wasn't marked when he got here. No one else evidently has found it. There are no flags here. There are no international flags. Nobody's got it marked that we found this place. We made this spot. I've got to do something and build a memorial here. And he's gone. And one by one, tedious and laboriously,
he piles up rocks one on another until he builds an altar and a pillar. And he stepped back and he said, this is Bethel, Beth House, El, God. This is the house of God. I met God here, face to face. This is where Christians start. This is the first dimension. You knew I'd get to that, didn't you? This is where they locate God. He had God geographically located. He has God spotted. That's why folks think that serving God is going to church, because their degree of spiritual perception has only reached the first dimension, and they know they've got to get back to church so they can get back with God, because to them, God is just a geographical location. House of God, got to get back. Bethel. Nothing wrong with finding a house to go to. No, certainly we must not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. I'm not decrying that. I'm just saying that that is only the smallest and the least of beginnings of things we should ever know about. God is where he is. Jacob's life will get more complicated from here on. He can't stay here forever. Hallowed as it is, as glorious as his vision was, the memory of those angels, how can you describe them? If he were an artist, he'd paint pictures. If he were a poet, he'd write poems. If he were a psalmist, he'd sing songs. But he's just a runaway man from an angry brother and a dying daddy. And his heritages have very small and punitive ideas and longevities. He's not worth anything. He's stolen what he's got. He connived for what he has. God isn't going to use him much. But he does know where God is. That's one thing. You know, he knows where God is. He got God located. That's God. There's the rocks right there. That's where God, that's the house of God. Right there. Well, he's going to go on down and visit some of his mama's relatives. Think I'll drop by and see Laban. Comes in. Hey, uncle, cousin, nephew. Ooh, hey, you know me? Yeah, Rebecca's boy. Esau. No, I'm Jacob. Oh, Jacob, heard about you. How's Esau? Last I saw him, he's in a bad way. Pretty ill-tempered boy he is. One of the reasons I left home. What do you mean? Oh, I just felt like it'd be better for him just to kind of be there with mom and dad by himself. You all have a little trouble? A little trouble, yeah. Not bad. How's your father? Last time I saw him, he was about ready to pass. He was trying to eat. Hard without teeth, you know. How you folks been? And about that time, here comes this pretty little thing walking across the yard. And Jacob's trying to talk to Uncle Laban here. How things been with you? Everything been going all right? Whoa, fox. Baby. That your girl? Yeah. What's her name? Rachel. You have a little work around here, man, could do? Yeah, I'll work for you for a while. Yeah. Big lay out, Doc. Yeah, I'll sign on for a little bit. Yeah, what? Raising cattle? I don't know much about that. I'm in the goat business myself. Oh, I was in the goat business. But the goat I had, she entered the ministry. And from there, it's just kind of a long story. My brother's upset, my daddy's dying, and my mama, I don't know. You know, I'd be glad to try to raise cows. What kind you got? Black ones and white ones. Oh, that's good. You ever seen any spotted ones? We might do something about that.
I tell you what I do. Cut you a deal. See, he's always cutting deals. That went across here just a minute ago? What'd you say her name? Rachel. How many years for? I work for her. I want her. I'm in love with her. I hadn't even seen her eyes, but I'm in love with her. He better look at both the daughter's eyes. But anyway, now it's another story, you know. Are y'all okay? Am I boring y'all to death? I'm really going to get to it here. But see, my theme is only going to last about 3 minutes when I get to it, so I got to tell a long story. That's true. I mean, it's got a real short ending. So he said, oh, could I just see her up close? Hey, Rachel, come here, hon. Got a young man here like to take a look at you. Ooh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Ah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hello, Rachel. I'm Jacob. I went to college and played on the football team. And oh, yeah, a lot of things. We'll talk about that later. I'm going to be around for a while. Sign on with your daddy here. I thought maybe we could have a little talk later in the evening. And first thing you know, they all, well, he works for her. And then it's time for him to get Rachel, and he's so excited. And they're going to have a wedding, and it's wonderful. Oh, this is marvelous. Now, you got to watch those Jewish weddings. The girls wear veils. And they all dance way up into the night. Didn't have a lot of electricity back then. Not much illumination. Couldn't see features too well. Always have weddings after dark. And they're all going to it, you know. And it's about 2 o'clock in the morning, and he's saying, well, it's been a wonderful party. Rachel. And here she is, wonderful, veil down over face. Oh, God bless you all. Thank you for everything. Been wonderful. I really enjoyed the evening. We'll see you tomorrow. God bless you. Get in there. And the Bible said they went in the tent, and she became his wife. And he woke up in the morning, and he said, Rachel, baby, you look so... I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings here. Listen. All of us have a little problem of some sort somewhere on our bodies or in our bodies. You know, all of us got a little something wrong. But Leah, she was the oldest daughter. Laban had tricked the trickster. It must have been in the genes. Went on back a little farther than Jacob. Come from mama's side. You can tell that right away. Oh, yeah. Because Laban had pawned off his oldest unmarriable daughter on Jacob. He comes out and, hey, I worked 7 years for Rachel. You gave me Leah. Well, it's okay before you looked at her this morning. You know, when he looked at her, he was a little shocked to it. Because the Bible said she had weak eyes. One translation said she was cross-eyed. We used to say where I came from, one eye looked at Dallas and the left one at Fort Worth. Don't want to hurt nobody's feelings, but when he looked into that mask of bewilderment, it reflected his whole soul. Ah. I'm confused, and she's confused, and we're confused. You're going to work 7 more years for Rachel. 7 more years. And he loved her. Come on, talk to me. He loved her. The Bible said the time passed as though it were just a day. Didn't even count. Didn't even matter. Yeah. And all the time, he's still tricking poor Laban. He's got some genetic thing going on down at the water hole. He's peeling the bark off of limbs. He's doing all kinds of tricky little stuff. Some of y'all probably biologically figured that all out, but I just don't know what he was doing down there exactly. Because said when the cows came down to water, when the goats and the sheep came down to get water, and when they were in their season, they'd take a look at that striped pole. See, the deal he'd cut was that everything that was either solid black or solid white belonged to Laban, but anything that was spotted, he got it. Well, his flocks and his herd, I mean, everything that's born spotted. He was messing with the gene structure down at the waterhole. I'm not going to get on into that, but man, he's a rich man. And then he decides to leave. Laban says, you can't go. He said, I got to go. Something yearning in him. See, sometimes our pasts are not so noble as the intensity of our possible futures. Sometimes the things we've lived through are not even repeatable in the face of the purpose of God for us. Sometimes the things we think have absolutely disqualified us away from anything God could use us for is only just ground to temper us and the chisel to facet us so that when God finally pulls away all of the excess from us, the purity of his purpose is more gorgeous than a gem, a diamond. Sometimes we can't see in us what God sees in us. A diamond in the rough, but a diamond sure enough. And so he leaves Laban, and he gets in trouble. His boys are growing up. They're getting to be men. And then I've got to hurry and tell you that one of his daughters went uptown one evening. Her name was Dinah. She went up to one of the Hittite villages, and Shechem, one of the young princes of the land, he liked her a lot, and he actually wooed her to his condo, is what the deal was. And she spent the night with him and all of that. Matter of fact, she stayed in town. And Jacob is trying his best to find out where Dinah is. And finally, news comes that this young Canaanite wants to marry his daughter. Well, anyway, the story's kind of long. In the meantime, the boys pull another nasty little trick. See, the gene thing goes on and on. You find it in Laban, you find it in Jacob, and now these guys, they're going to trick all these men. You don't want me to talk about that, do you? You do? Well, they said, you want to marry our sister? Not a problem. Not a problem, but we don't want any dowry and don't bring us any money. What we want is you to enter into a covenant with us. And that covenant is circumcision. So what we want you to do, all you boys in town, we want you to get circumcised. Is this going to be on television? And so they did. They said, hey, it's worth it if the prince in town wants her badly enough, wants to marry Dinah, and if it takes us all getting circumcised. But the problem was, on the third day, the Bible said, while they were still having a problem, they were sore. Jacob's boys all came down and killed him. Killed every man in town. And then you know what they're doing? They're running for their life again. There they go. He's always going someplace. In the meantime, he's had a meeting with Esau. He wrestled at the brook. Remember that one. Yeah, he knows he's about to meet Esau. Esau is coming, news came, with 400 armed men. So he takes his family, puts them across on this side, and he goes back across, and the Bible said they wrestled with him there, a man. And I don't have time to tell you about that wrestling match, but I do know that it had to be a long, lusty, musty, mighty fight. Gravel and blood and guts and grit and snot and all kinds of stuff flying and let me go. I'll break your wing.
Let go of my halo! Now! The only way that angel got loose was he, before daybreak, he said, let me go the day Bokars breaketh. Time for order, time for lineup. He had to line up, he had to go up that ladder. Time to go, it's daybreak, I gotta go. No, I'm not letting you go till you bless me. I gotta have more than an earthly blessing. He understood something about kingdom. It's not enough to get touched in the earth, you gotta get touched in the heavenlies. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. My daddy's touched me, but now my daddy's touch with this misaligned spirit is not enough. You touch me, you bless me. I'm gonna bless you and touch you. All right, thank you. Appreciate it. He limped into the sunrise, met his brother, fell on him. Instead of the cold steel, it was warm arms, hairy arms. Should have called him Harry. And it seemed to be over. It really wasn't. That's another message. But it seemed to be over, at least for the time. And then after the Shechem deal, man, they're running for their life. And God said, you better go back to Bethel. Okay. Simeon, Issachar, you go get the camels. Dan, Zebulun, would you bring up all the goats and sheep? Judah, get the musical instruments and stuff right, Bob. We've got to sing a little bit while walking home. Oh. Oh. Hey. All right, bring up the wagon. Get Mom in the wagon. How's Joseph doing? Good boy, isn't he? Man, oh, he is too. He's a good-looking boy. Bring him on up here. You got that coat. Get that coat. I made one. Get that coat on him. Okay, where we going? I got a spot over here someplace. I got God located. We need to get back to God. I need to get back to God. Yeah. I need to get back to God. I know where God is. I'm going to church. Up over this hill, just a little bit farther. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, just a little bit. Here. Come on. Come. Oh, I see. See a rock down there? See a rock? Hey. Dan, go on. See a rock? Put the mama on. Well, I was a little younger. I didn't have this thing, you know, that angel. But, yeah, stacked him up myself right there. Holy place here. This is the door of heaven right here. It's where God lives. Got God located. But when he got back this time, he'd been through some things. When he got back this time, he had seen some process. When he got back this time, he had been more tempered. This time, he's going to pour out oil and water and meal on this altar. He's going to build up another pillar. But this time, he's not going to call it Bethel. He's coming back in the second dimension. You go through some things. You walk through some valleys. You've been through some fire. You've been in some drowning, raging rivers. You survived by the grace of God. Everybody who's been touched of God has a limp somewhere. Any man taken from among men to be made a priest over men must offer sacrifice for himself as for the people. He's going to have shed some blood for himself because he's going through some stuff. He's not going to be a man of God, and he'll never be chosen of God if he doesn't go through stuff. We think God always chooses men who don't have a pimple on them, you know? And the truth is that God says that these men must have compassion on the ignorant and them that are out of the way, in that they themselves have been surrounded by infirmity. He's been completely encompassed by unstable situations in his life. That's what qualifies him to be made a priest. Now he's going to offer a greater offering to God. He's going to pour out oil on this thing. And he's not going to call it Bethel, house of God. He's going to call it El Bethel. Now I know where God is, but coming through what I've been through, walking where I've walked, I know more than where I got. God, I know more than the house of God. Now I know the God of the house. El. It looks like knowing where God is and knowing who God is should be enough. And there is where most of us cease. That's where we find it convenient to stop. But it's the irritation in his spirit Now that he's been through it, now that he's been processed, now that he understands more about destiny and God and purpose, there's an undercurrent in his spirit, an insatiable thirst that even his family cannot quench. Going back night after night to that pile of rocks and standing by it and leaning on it and still looking for that hole in heaven, waiting for that silver shaft to stamp itself at his feet and watch those angels come and go. Night after night, he's wondering if twinkling stars might be descending angels. I wonder if they're coming this way. Something's irritating him. And he got up in the morning and said, Issachar, I want you to bring the wagons up. Zebulon, strike the tents. Dan, get the younger boys. Go bring up the goats. Bring up the camels. What are we going to do, Daddy? We're going to move.
You can't move. This is where God lives. We don't only know where God is. We know who God is. Hallelujah. Bless his heart, Taya. Yes. You can't move. We got everything we need. This is what God's been doing. This is what we've been reaching for. Where are you going to go?
We're going to Ephrata.
Going where?
To Ephrata. I think that was my text when I started. We're going to Ephrata.
Why?
I don't know.
There's another pile of rocks over there. When you were young, like this, you said, you know, did you pile some other rocks up?
No. Never been there. Never been there? What's it look like? I don't know.
Why don't we just stay here with what we know? There's good stuff here.
Know where God is. Got God located.
Know who God is. Don't see any reason why we ought to be going anywhere, do you? How come you're all upset? Why are you divinely discontent? Why are you divinely discontent? Why are you not satisfied? Why do you say you gotta have more? Why? What is it you think you gotta have? You don't even know. You've never been there. What is that something that itches your spirit in a place your Holy Ghost can't scratch? What is it somewhere down deep inside you somewhere that makes you feel like there still is something way beyond what you've ever seen? We've never yet even seen it. We've never yet even touched it. There's a dimension of the spirit. What we are seeing now is simply man and God. We've never seen it when it's just all God. When man steps back and says, how can you lead this? How can you conduct this? How can you order this? How can you moderate this? Something so powerful, something so mighty that it can't be organized. It cannot even be computed.
How do you know? Well, you ever seen that? No.
How do you know it's there? We got to go. But you ought to be satisfied with it. Look at the heritage you got. You know where God is, and you know who God is. You ought to be pleased and thankful. You ought to stand in this place and move in this place and walk in this place. You can come back here every evening and enjoy this. It's pretty good. What's this idea about going to Ephrata? What's that? Well, it's just a little way. How far is it? 5 miles. Only 5 miles from Bethel? 5 miles. Just a little way. It was just a little way to come to Ephrata. What are you going to Ephrata for? But Daddy? Now we're going to get Judah. Daddy? I don't think Mama's fit to travel. Why not? Well, she's expecting the baby. Huh, so? We traveled when she's expecting another baby. Look at Leah, poor thing. We traveled, she had 10 babies. It's probably the reason why she had so many. Oh, the weather. I think we're gonna get some rain. Yeah. Oh, Daddy, we can't go. Mama, she's expected. She's going to have this baby anytime. We can't go now. Load up the wagon. Come on. Rachel, baby. Hey, Rachel. Come on. It's going to be okay. Get on in the wagon there. Get the midwife. Put it in there with her. Get some good old furs and blankets. Put them in it. Get that old goat skin. Yeah, I brought all the way. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I've had that with me a long time, 35, 36 years, yeah. You notice they don't have any legs on. I cut them off, had them wrapped around my arm. But other than that, pretty nice pelt, you know. Oh. Put it in there, get it on in there now. Let's come on, boys, bring up the camels. All right, let's get the goats. Move on. Oh, we're going to Ephrata. What are we going to Ephrata for? What's in Ephrata? Is it prettier?
I don't know.
Is it cleaner?
I don't know.
You got a better job there?
I don't know.
I'd like to dedicate this to the men and women who filed across the stage from all over the world here this evening. What drives you when you're hungry to go and preach anyway? What makes you want to go after you've started this work and it could bring you a few pieces in your hand and you could feed your family better than you could before, but why do you keep going on and you're going to the next village? What is that driving in you? What is that something? Jacob couldn't have known why he was going. Ephrata, Ephrata. What's the deal with Ephrata? Ephrata, the ancient name for Bethlehem. Thou, Ephrata, Bethlehem, though thou be the least among all the princes of thy people, yet out of you shall come he who shall rule my people, Israel. Yeah, but the prophet didn't say that to Jacob. The prophet wasn't even born yet. He can't know that Ephrata is special. He can't know there's a place beyond where he is that's powerful. He doesn't know. He's never been there, never seen that. It's not a big... I'm just going to preach to you now and tell you. There's a place just beyond us in the kingdom now that is just a little way from here. But there's a chance you may lose the most precious thing you love on the way to Ephrata. You gotta be willing to give up your life's pursuit. You've got to be willing to give up your greatest love. It's a little trip, but it's a rough road to the third dimension of grace, where God works with you all by himself. Bring him on up. What'd you stop the wagon for? Mama what? Sick. Sure she's sick. She's gonna have a baby. What? Having a baby. Oh yeah? Midwife's in there, isn't she? Come on. Having a problem? What kind of problem? Oh, stand. Stop. Holy goat. Holy goat's up over there. Stop the camera. By the time he got back and around to the back of that old wagon and looked in, the midwife is holding 8 pounds of wet love in her arms. The midwife is crying, shaking her head. He looks down at his Rachel. Everything okay? Rachel? Rachel? What he loves the most is laying there still. Rachel?
Hey, baby. Rachel?
Huh? Midwife still. She called his name. Benoni, son of my sorrow. Jacob looked at that wet baby, down at his deepest love. Rachel, raven locks. He closed the lids on those dark black eyes. I love you, baby. He lost the most precious thing he had on the way to Ephrata. When he finally took that little baby in his arms and backed up into the sunlight, he said, his name is not Benoni. His name is Benjamin. He is not the son of my sorrow. He's the son of power. He's the son of my right hand.
what you thought was your wilderness is really only God's holding place for you until your time of showing unto Israel. What you thought was your absolute abandonment is God's holding you until Pharaoh's heart is hard enough to deliver his people. Where you thought you had been stricken and cast off to, all the struggles, even some of our own making, God finds no difference in those and those that come against us. It doesn't matter. The truth is that if we wander on beyond the places we can see and touch into an indefinite, nebulous, absolute promise, there is an ephatah beyond us that we have never seen or touched. And you say, well, what's the big deal? The big deal is he's got to be there. He doesn't even know why he's got, but he's got to be there. Why? He doesn't know. What do you got to be there for? I don't know. Well, it's something to do with you. I don't know. I just got to go. Why? I just got to go. Some of you are feeling I just have to do something. You need to not quench that. We need to stop. Move out of our ceasing places and say, I am going to move somewhere. God, show me where to go. It doesn't make sense to my carnal mind. I'm not talking about packing up and leaving town. I'm talking about in your spirit. I'm talking about going from where you are in your spirit. We've got worlds of Christians who sit Sunday after Sunday and pat a cake for Jesus and mouth the words with the choir. They're just as carnal as bears, and they're just as faithful as they want to be, depending on what else is going on in town. But a little bit of process stirs in him. He's got to go to Ephatah. Why has he got to go to Ephatah? He has to go to Ephatah because he's got to bring his family there. Why? He's got to. But he's going to lose something precious. That's all right. Got to go. Why has he got to go? Why to Ephrata? Because that's Bethlehem. So what's the big deal? Well, he's got to go. He has to take his sons there so they can have their sons there. So they can have their sons there. There has to be a sire seed that walks out before anyone else limps into that place, because it is in Ephrathah that Boaz will meet Ruth. But Boaz will be the great, 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 great grandson of Jacob. And Boaz and Ruth, a Gentile bride, will have a baby boy, and his name will be Obed. And he'll grow up there where that sire seed limped in one day, where other men had never thought to dwell, by a prophetic insight, by a glorious holy call. God has a place for you beyond where you are. A dimension you've never seen. He has to be there because Obed will have Jesse there. And Jesse will have David there. And even blind beggars will someday call a Messiah. Thou son of David, someday in a little stable back just probably a stone's throw from where they pitched their lonely tents after they buried Mama on the way to Ephrathah. There, just a stone's throw away, at a cave and a stable, Jesus will be born, and he will be son of David, son of Jesse, son of Obed, son of Boaz, son of Solomon, son of Jacob. God is taking some of us places we've never been before. And you will never know why you have to go through what you go through on your way to Ephrathah. But your generations will rise up and give the world a Jesus because you went there.
Sometimes people ask how we found this beautiful little valley that God has given to us, and sometimes they are wondering how we found this peace we have in our lives right now. And I have to tell them it has been a rough little road. A lot of pain, a lot of process, sometimes a lot of misunderstanding. But I can tell you that it's been worth every mile. On this trip into the greater dimension of God's purpose, sometimes we have to lose the things we love the most. But what you gain is so much more than you lose. It certainly is worth it. We'd love to invite you to come back to the ranch with us. I wish we could bring you all back here today. Since we can't, we're just going to encourage you to come with us on this way into God's purpose for your life. We're looking forward to seeing you soon again. God bless you. Bye-bye.